Hello everyone, and welcome to theCUBE's coverage of HIMSS 2025 here at the Venetian in Las Vegas. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight. We are here with Google and many of its ecosystem partners talking about the future of healthcare innovation and agentic AI, and what an exciting future it is. We have two great guests for you now. We have Aashima Gupta. She is the Director of Healthcare Solutions at Google Cloud. Thank you so much for coming back on the show, Aashima.
Glad to be here.
And we have Nneka Emegwa. She is Managing Director, Google Cloud, U.S. Health and Public Services at Accenture. Thank you so much, Nneka, for coming on the show.
Yeah, thank you for having me. Excited to be here. Thank you.
So as I said, we are here at HIMSS, which is the epicenter of healthcare innovation. And we know that AI in healthcare is evolving rapidly and changes are afoot that promise to transform the entire industry and the way that care is delivered. But before we can even talk about or dream about change, I need you to level set for us where we are at this particular moment. Why don't you tell our viewers a little bit about how you see the industry today, Nneka?
Today, yeah. Actually, I think there are two favorite alphabets in this conference, and I think you can guess what they are. It's A and it's I. So it's a very timely topic, by the way. Mm-hmm. Lots of huge potential. Mm-hmm. I think in terms of just where we are, there's a lot of low-hanging quick wins that people are getting into, our organizations, our clients are getting into, to start to think about, you know, the customer experiences or even productivity for their employees. So I think if I'm to mention maybe a couple of them, is around like documentation. Mm-hmm. I would say is the very low-hanging fruit where you can start to use this intelligent or digital colleague who is taking notes for you, doing summarization for the healthcare practitioners. And I know that there's a lot of attrition. There's even shortage of staff, healthcare practitioners, right? Our nurses are so stretched out. Mm-hmm. And so part of that is just the burden of this documentation. So if we can do some of that, have AI start to do some of that work for them, that's where we're starting to see a lot of interest. And then if you get into things like prior authorization, you know, so the AI basically can read those documents, understand them, and start to apply them in different contexts. So we're seeing that. I do also see like remote working, remote monitoring, picking up, telehealth is a big one. I know that COVID accelerated that, right? But these days, that's what it is. It's a norm now, the hybrid model for that. And so using AI to accelerate that process, to take notes, to summarize, to just take some of that burden off of the practitioners is definitely what I'm seeing today.
Well, you've mentioned a lot of big issues in terms of staff shortages, burnout among healthcare workers, the onerous amounts of time and paperwork that is involved in healthcare that everyone from doctors and practitioners to patients themselves appreciate and understand. Now let's actually start dreaming big and thinking about the future. So we're level setting. This is where we are right now. In terms of the future, what are some of the biggest trends that you're seeing that are most exciting to you? We're going to talk about all the obstacles that are getting in the way of that, but before we get there, let's talk about what is most exciting to you. I want to ask you both this, but Nneka, I want to start with you.
Okay, I'm excited about the promise of AI. I think that the cloud is a big enabler for what we're dealing with today. You just can't do it without the cloud. But when you layer on the data, which is driving everything, and then get to Gen AI, so AI, Gen AI, and now agentic, it's like firepower. So I think the future is so limitless. For us in Accenture, we have a tech vision we put out every year. So this year's tech vision is all about, as you can imagine, it's all about the future of AI. But we have different trends, and one key one is the first one we mentioned, which is the Big Bang. And what that is the binary Big Bang, actually. It's this explosion of AI. Yeah. It's this autonomous system, right? If you think about AI going beyond just being a tool for automation, but now it's your big digital companion, is this system providing this intelligence, the growth of intelligence. And so in the healthcare, we talk about, for example, I'll give an example, which is like, if you think about the emergency room of the future. So there, let's say a patient comes in, right? Of course, driven to the OR by an autonomous vehicle, autonomous ambulance to start with. And then these agents are pulling, the digital agents are pulling all this information before the patient arrives from their wearables, pulling their healthcare information, correlating all that, checking the OR capacity. So basically it starts to help our healthcare givers to start to solve problems even before the patient arrives. So that's one of the big ones, like really having AI be a big system accompanying our healthcare providers to make their work easier and provide the best experience for the patients.
That is an incredible scenario that she has just laid out. Aashima, for AI to succeed in healthcare, the right foundations need to be in place. What do you see as the key building blocks in terms of data infrastructure, partnerships, governance, that organizations need to focus on first before we can get to that futuristic ER that Nneka just showcased?
I think it all starts with, I think we talk about AI models like we all have seen in the past 2 years, that they have come to the mainstream. But what we are hearing back from our customers is that it's not just enough about having a model. How do you serve those models? Where is the platform approach where ability to A, serve those models, but these models also drift? How are you going to deploy? How are you going to scale? How are you going to monitor them? And it's a new level of engineering. They need to be secured in a different way. Prompt engineering has now come to the forefront. And so we are seeing, and this is where from Google we offer as a Vertex AI, it's our platform, because it's not just enough to do one use case. I think what I worry is a lot of scattered experiments. How do you move those scattered experiments to an ROI-based solution in a holistic way? And that starts with having the right foundation. And to us, that's a platform play. Models are integral game changer, but foundation equally, if not more important. So my message is think platform, think how you're going to serve it. The enterprise grade privacy, security is table stakes. And especially
Absolutely.
When you talk agents, orchestration of those agents, how much agency would those agents have, right? And enterprises, be the ER workflow or take any workflow, they are deterministic. They follow these steps. Generative AI is probabilistic. So how do you match these two to serve a task? Again, you need a platform to be able to configure all these, and that's where we shine, and this is what our platform offers.
At the core of a lot of what you're saying is trust.
Yep.
So how do you recommend healthcare organizations, what practical steps would you recommend they take in order to build trust, to make sure that everyone from patients to payers to others, other stakeholders, see that these AI-driven decisions are reliable and transparent? I'll start with you, Aashima.
So I would say 100% agree, Rebecca. Healthcare moves at the speed of trust. And that is first, then performance, then the cost. Like if you're thinking about either including a solution, trust is at the top. I would say from Google perspective, some best practice to share is we established our AI principles back in 2018. For organization getting into that AI transformation journey, how many of them have the AI principles?
Right.
How many have the governance processes in place? For us, each product, each partnership is then evaluated as a governance framework around that. And so self-governance is key.
Yep.
And establishing those AI strategies, starting at the top, starting at the principal way of looking into it, and of course then enterprise, privacy, security, like that's, you're talking about patient-sensitive data.
Yeah.
And then going beyond, evaluation framework. What does good look like? How would you know the output of the model created is actually good? So, again, evaluation frameworks. And finally, doing it with the people that you're doing it for. So, it's not to them, it's with them. So, if you're building a nurse solution, we worked with HCA and their nurses were huge part of it. They actually told us which use case, and they are the ones evaluating it, giving the feedback. So doing it with them, not to them.
Nneka, building on what Aashima was saying, AI success depends on high quality data. Mm-hmm. What are some of the biggest data challenges that you see in healthcare, and how can organizations overcome them?
Yeah, I would say that it's a lot of garbage in, garbage out, right? If you put in the wrong data, you don't expect something different. So it's really understanding what your landscape looks like. First of all, you start with the problem you're trying to solve, right? What is the human problem? And then what do you need to enable underneath that? And so I think that is some of our organizations we work with have a lot of legacy systems, where even data is residing in so many disparate systems. And so how do you bring all that together so you can make sense out of data? Because at the end of the day, you're trying to get insights, you're trying to get analytics. So it's really about thinking about your data platform. How do you bring, I mean, to your point of platform, right? How do you build that good and secure data platform? And then how do you start to layer on things like that? So I would say that just in consideration, to think about your landscape, think about the systems you have. Maybe there's a need to augment the system you have. Maybe there's a need to revamp the system you have. But it's starting to start to reimagine your system and what could be possible. But I also want to touch on what she talked about on trust. We did a finding, Accenture did, and we found that 81% of executives say that, you know, trust, it has to evolve as technology evolves. So for these technologies, everything we see here at HIMSS to be adopted, there has to be trust, right? It's not just trust between the patient and the system, the caregivers and the system, but even system to system trust too. So I think that's very important, and putting the right guardrails around what you need to. Well, I guess not just the input, but also output, right? We need to check what's going in, but also what's being spit out by the system. Make sure that it's according to what you expect.
And to add to Nneka, trust is earned. It's not just handed out. It's not given. So early those POCs, those pilots, those experiments, they will pave the way. So what are we doing to earn that trust? I think that's hard work, right?
And one of the reasons it can be hard to trust AI is because of the ethical concerns around AI. So how should organizations approach issues like bias and security and equitable access in terms of making sure that they are, these AI-driven decisions are in fact trustworthy?
Do you want to start off?
Yeah, so I think what we have seen is when these health equity concerns, bias concerns are real. But if you also think about it, the bias exists in the data for decades, right? Imagining AI to come be the magical eraser and erase that, that's a very inflated expectation. But where AI can be actually good is that collaborator. Is my response more biased? Can you use this tool? And when you think about increasing access, can AI agents now expand the reach of healthcare expertise to the underserved areas?
That's right. To me,
AI is that amplifier where used right, it can actually help us identify our bias. It can help reach much more underserved population and be a tool in an arsenal.
And I would say also that you can use AI to solve AI issues, like the bias and all that. If you think of agentic and the agents, you could also build an agent that does that, right? Maybe it's a critic agent that keeps looking at your process, making sure that things are coming out as expected, and then also suggesting, recommending improvements to that too. So it's an ongoing process. It's not a build once and let it run. You know, as things evolve, you have to check your guardrails, you have to check security too, right? You have to think of your access around all that too. So it's evolving. I would definitely recommend people have maybe a center of excellence and a group of people who are continuously not just using these models, but also evaluating the security and trust around them.
Well, my last questions to you are around how we get started here. One of the things that Aashima has talked a lot about here on the show is the future of agentic AI and AI agents transforming how care is delivered. Nneka, what are your thoughts in terms of how organizations should actually start implementing these things with practical steps? You talked about a center of excellence. Are there any other pieces of advice that you would offer?
I would say maybe the center of excellence is more even for more mature organizations on the journey. If you're just starting, I'll say get started. Use it. Use the ones that are readily available. We talked about quick wins. You know, if it's like Gemini in Workspace, use Gemini. Like, don't be afraid to use AI. And also encourage your employees to use them. Because I think if you create that environment where people can use and experiment and fail fast, then it becomes part of the culture, right? People are not afraid to use AI for greater things. So I would say it, just get started. Think of the human problems you would like to solve. Do you want a virtual, you know, caregiver, a digital caregiver that would help the elderly to look at their medications or schedule things for them and all that? Or do you want, you know, there's so many things. You know, AI can help with patient education.
Yeah.
So if it's just that, having the AI put together like hyper-personalized education and all that, you can start with the low-hanging fruit before you start to think of robotics, for example, you know, and integrating all that with the LLMs. So again, I would say get started, think of where you are, where you need to be, but also how do you get to your point from the pilots and the POCs to production,
right?
Because that's where you want to get to.
Well, you've hit on an interesting point, and that is that in order for all of this to work, you have to get the people excited to use it. So, as you said, thinking about ways, think about problems that you want to solve, thinking about parts of your job that you don't like, that you wish you could automate.
Right.
How do you get people excited to experiment? That's great
advice.
Nneka, Aashima, thank you both so much for coming on theCUBE. A great conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks, Aashima. Thank you.
I'm Rebecca Knight. Stay tuned for more of our live coverage from HIMSS 2025. You're watching theCUBE.